First, my apologies. Yes, some of these are a little bit fuzzy. It's not your eyes, but they'll do. Beggars can't be choosers, and I can't really be too choosy with this. The first alteration to the concentric zone model came in 1939 from Homer Hoyt, the Hoyt sector model. There you see it right there. You can see by looking at it that it maintains the basic structure of the concentric zone model, but it adds a little complexity to it, most notably a transportation corridor that runs through the model city. Can you see that in purple? This can also morph into an extension along a major transportation route that causes the service sector of the CBD to stretch out and elongate, as we're going to see momentarily. Visually, you can see it starts to look a little bit like the slices of an orange, like the wedges of an orange when you cut an orange into the wedges. Doesn't it kind of have that look in a way? The model assumes that the main transportation system is founded on railways, which, while important in the United States, of course, are not as important as the road or highway systems for overall transportation, particularly commercial transportation and moving us around from point A to point B just for something to do. Do you get on a train if you live in Southern California to go from one place to another? Mostly you do not. There are some places along the eastern seaboard where that's pretty important, and of course in other places in the world, but not so much in the United States. Urban areas or urban regions, like suburbs or industrial zones, stretch outward from the CBD. They don't encircle it the way they did with the concentric zone model. His reasoning, as in Hoyt's reasoning, was that like landscapes, in other words, similar landscapes, would remain the same as distance was increased from the CBD. So, for example, a wealthy neighborhood that was originally next to the CBD would grow outwards from the CBD. This is in contrast to the concentric zone model, which assumes people would move farther and farther from the CBD as time progressed in order to avoid the supposed problems of the inner city, as I mentioned last time. If you take a look, you can see that in a way, the von Thunen model was modified in a similar way, if you recall this. That when you had a transportation route, like a river, what ends up happening is all of those circles stretch out along the transportation route. In a way, this is an application of that modification to the von Thunen model, only this is a modification of the concentric zone model. So take a look again at that Hoyt sector model. Right? And notice that in the sector model, the CBD remains as it was in the concentric zone model. It's in the middle and it's circular. But the addition of the transportation corridor elongates the industrial areas along the transportation route. You can see that right there where I've highlighted it. I circled it on the diagram on the right-hand side, and I have the red arrow pointing at it on the diagram on the left-hand side. So this elongated transportation route naturally is going to, in this case, elongate the industrial areas along the transportation route that in the concentric zone model had surrounded the CBD. Remember, this was zone number two. This concept for the sector model is based on the idea that industry, factories, manufacturing centers need quality transportation in order to move raw materials in and large finished products out. Okay, because a lot of times you have heavy raw materials coming into the factory and then heavy products coming out, and those need a transportation network to move things in and out. So the Wilshire Corridor along Wilshire Boulevard in Los Angeles demonstrates a similar thing. So the Wilshire Corridor, sorry, it's hard for me to say that, my apologies, in Los Angeles does a similar thing, but in this case, it's vis-a-vis the service sector. So the service sector that's centered in the CBD, in the center of the city, the tertiary sector, is going to stretch out along an important transportation corridor, in this case, Wilshire Boulevard, which you can see right there. The red arrow is pointing at downtown Los Angeles, the CBD, and then I've circled the Wilshire Corridor there in white, and now you can see it again. It follows Wilshire Boulevard, and it is lots of services, lawyers, management services, things related to the movie industry, all kinds of things like that. Then, okay, hold on to yourself. You can see what Hoyt called the low-class residential zone, which would be found next to the heavy industry and transportation corridor. So next to number two, number three is next to number two. And you can see I circled it on the diagram and I have the arrow pointing at it as well. Now, of course, I would not use the term low-class residential. So I have a problem with that terminology, but we could call it working class. That for sure would be okay. But he referred to it as low-class residential. And certainly there is some validity to poorer neighborhoods accumulating in areas that are going to be traffic dense and pollution dense and environmental hazard dense and maybe noisy and lacking a wide range of social and recreational services and opportunities for the people who live in them. And of course, again, this would be a lot of concentration of people of color and first generation immigrants. And then you can see after that, we have the middle class residential neighborhoods, which make up a fairly substantial part of the city. And then that's followed by the high class residential neighborhoods. And remember, these are terms that he used. These aren't my terms. And notice that all of these urban components touch the CBD. This is a primary characteristic of the sector model. And if we look at the high class residential, you might say, well, is there anything like that? Well, yeah, if you think about it, Beverly Hills, Brentwood, Westwood, they all kind of stretch out and get very close to downtown Los Angeles. So, in a way, yeah. And we know that these are famous places, very wealthy places, lots of space in them. The property values are high, and the people who live there overwhelmingly have quite a lot of money.